Send out your light and your truth, that they may lead me and bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ, and welcome to River Lawn Presbyterian Church this morning. We're so happy that you're here to worship together and to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Pastor Chris is away today, and we welcome back our good friend and brother, Rick Wolford. Rick, we're just delighted that you're here, and we feel blessed to have you bringing the message this morning. I'd call your attention to the announcements. There's, and I'll highlight a couple of them. The Ladies Bible Study starts tomorrow at 1 p.m. in the cottage. There'll be a deacons meeting after church today. And next Sunday is Super Bowl Sunday, so we need to continue to bring in food donations. This year we're going to have a little different twist on our traditional soup and sandwich meal that we have. Usually it's done after church, but this week we're going to do it on Wednesday night, and we'll have soup, sandwich, and dessert on Wednesday night along with our traditional family night. And then Super Bowl Sunday will continue next Sunday, February 12th, is scheduled. We hope you'll feel welcome and will join us Wednesday night, and bring a friend or two. You know, don't come by yourselves. You're also welcome and encouraged, we say this every week, to attend the Biddy basketball activities in the gym every Saturday. It starts about 9 and they're done by noon. And you can stay for all of it or come for a little bit of it if you'd like, and just have a seat. And usually when you sit down, you end up speaking to somebody that's sitting next to you. So it's a good way for us to welcome people into our midst here at River Lawn. It's an important ministry that we have, obviously. It's one of the greatest things I think we do here. Are there any other announcements? I think we have an announcement from Pam about the prelude. You want to?
Okay. Let me say something real quick. Becky wonderfully put out a letter to ask for volunteers for the nursery, and the response was so overwhelming that I got no volunteer. So if you all would just think about it, the more people, like I said, if we get 8 people, that's once every 2 months. If we get 12 people, that's once every 3 months. But if you, I mean, we do have, I think, a big staff of 30. So we, you know, if you all would just think about whether you'd be able to, you know, help in that capacity. And I did have a lot of volunteers for the Biddy basketball Sunday, which was wonderful. So I think we're good there, but that was just all I wanted to say. In case you all skipped that email, which I'm sure is what it was, for later time, so thank you.
You don't have to keep kids or anything from what I'm going to ask of you. You just have to sit and listen to my song. The prelude is an arrangement of the hymn tune Hydrofall. It's a Welsh tune. It was written by a man named Pritchard, who was an amateur musician. But this has become probably one of the most popular tunes in all of hymnody, because it's been used in a lot of different hymnals. In our hymnal, there are 4 or 5 songs or hymns that are put to this tune. Hafradal in Welsh means pleasant or delightful. So it is a nice little tune. I think you'll recognize it. As I play this, I think of the words on page 309, I will sing of my Redeemer. And the last phrase is that, is paid the debt and set me free. So I like that part of that. This is an alternate harmonization. So don't go, oh, poor Pam, she's made all these mistakes. There are a few little notes in there that it's like, wonder why they put that in there. But this particular setting is by Hops.
Thank you.
Let's stand now and join in singing our opening hymn, hymn 210, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. Brothers and sisters, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Confident in God's grace, let us now silently confess our sins against God and our neighbors. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and soul and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are. And direct what we shall be, so that we might delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone, and a new life has begun. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. old days, we got out of the choir loft a lot quicker.
Well, we're all suffering from that. While we're giving them a chance to find their seats this morning, I would tell you of a story I heard just last week. This woman goes into her Presbyterian minister, who will remain unnamed, office, and says, "Pastor, I've got to tell you something terrible has happened. My dog died. And I would like for you to do the service." Minister looked at her and he said, "Well, ma'am, I'm afraid to tell you this, but we don't do services for animals, but I can probably find one or two people in the community that would be more than happy to do the services for your dog." And she said, "Well, I understand quite well, and don't worry about it, it's not a problem. But before I leave, can you answer me one more question?" And he said, "Well, of course." And he said, "When the person does the funeral, should I give them $300 or $400? And the pastor looked at her and he said, "Well, you know, wait a minute, I didn't realize your dog was Presbyterian." Now that you're all in your seats, this could be a really good day or a bad month for you, because some of you have been so kind to say, "We're glad to see you back." And I said, "Don't wish for what you don't want, because I'm going to be here next Sunday also." So, our gospel this morning is from the 5th chapter of Matthew, beginning at verse 13. "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. And in the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter nor the least stroke of a pen will by any means disappear from the law until everything has been accomplished. Anyone who breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven." Gospel of our Lord. Well, grace, mercy, and peace to you this morning. And if you hadn't figured it out, our lesson this morning comes from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And this comes just after he had blessed the crowd with the Beatitudes, and he was describing the characteristics of being a good and faithful disciple and follower of his. So this morning we look at the second part about the attributes and responsibilities of discipleship. Or really, in a simpler way, to answer that question that we all have at some point in our lives been worried about: why am I here? And it reminded me of a story that I'd heard many years ago about three little boys, and They were playing in the front yard when a fire truck zoomed by and the sirens were blaring. And sitting in the very front of the fire truck was a beautiful Dalmatian with his black and white spots. And as the boys saw the dog and they started to try to figure out why the dog was there and what was the dog's role for the firefighters, and one five-year-old boy said, well, I know, they use him to keep the crowds back when they're going to a fire. The second one said, no, that's not it. He's just there for luck. And the third little boy, who happened to be 6 years old, was very definitive about his answer, and he said, I know why he's there. They use him to find the fire hydrants. And in trying to figure out why this dog was there, these kids were really dancing pretty close to our question this morning, is why are we here? What is our purpose in life? What exactly is our role? And even more to that, I ask myself, what is the purpose of my life and what am I supposed to be about? And well, let me ask you, if I could, who are you? How do you answer someone that asks you that question? So we're going to try to do a little visual this morning. So this gentleman right here, my name is Rick Wolford. I run a small investment company. I live in Charleston. I've got a few kids and a lot of grandkids. Tell me something about yourself.
My wife and I have lived in St. Albans for 45 years. We're both retired, and we have a great time out here, and we like to go camping.
Well, thank you, Paul. And that seems pretty nondescript, because it uses both of us. The most common answers is to give our name. We might tell a little bit about our family history or where we lived or where we went to school, and maybe something about our work or how we spend our time. But I can't think of a single time in my life that I answered the question by saying, oh, I'm the salt of the earth and I am the light of the world. So let me ask you this morning, have you ever answered anybody that way? Because you and I just don't seem to think of ourselves, but Jesus does. And he said that about us this morning. I just read it to you. He said, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. And I don't think he's talking only to the disciples or the crowd that was gathered there that day, because like so many of Jesus' stories, you and I are in that crowd that he's addressing. We're one of them. We showed up this morning to see the one that we've heard about. We've come to listen and to learn his word and to be healed and to be fed, that we may get our lives together once again. We also came in search of meaning and direction, just like the crowd that day that he would soon feed with fish and bread. And Jesus' words are just as true and meaningful today as they were over 2,000 years ago when he first spoke them. You are the salt of the earth. And as I thought about that this week, I thought, well, what exactly does that mean, salt of the earth? And think about what salt is. It's very common. It's ordinary. It's an ingredient that I would almost guarantee is on every one of your all's kitchen tables. It's not expensive, but it has an extremely important role. Could you imagine food without salt? It would be tasteless, because you and I use salt to spice it up, and sometimes, especially, you know, some of you may have had high blood pressure, you use a little too much of the salt, because it usually just takes a very small amount to season our food and to bring out the flavors. A little salt goes a long way. We use it as a preservative to keep things from spoiling. And maybe that particular day, I'm just guessing, Jesus was thinking about all of the things in the world then that were rotting, just like you and I see today. You know, salt can be used as an antiseptic. It can clean open wounds. It can be used as a household cleanser to clean up a dirty mess. And we like our salt on the roads when it snows to keep us safe, to get us back and forth. Salt plays an extremely important role in many aspects of our life. And similarly, when you think about it, what would we do without light? Even the smallest amount of light that you can think of, maybe even a low-volt candle, can prevail in the darkness. And we think back to the story, as Jesus probably did at the time of creation, with the "let there be light." What would we do today without light or electricity? Because it's the source of power that enables us to prepare our food. It powers our houses. It keeps us warm in the winter and cool in the summer. But most importantly, with the single switch, it gives us light. And we take it for granted until we don't have it. Police tell us to avoid dark places at night for safety and stay in well-lit places. So it is not surprising at all to hear Jesus tell us, "You are the salt of the earth and you are the light of the world." Because both salt and light sustain, preserve, and maintain life. And what is important to know is when we heard Jesus talking today, he's not saying, you know, you will be light, or if you study real hard, you might become light, or you might try to be light. Jesus is saying to each one of us, you are salt and you are light now. And as such, we are to season the world around us now, because we're not the main course. That's Jesus. And we're here to lighten the world as a disciple for the light of the world, Jesus Christ. You and I are here to bring taste to the earth and shed light on the darkness that we see around us. And you know, I really think, as simple as this sounds, this is a hard lesson for us Presbyterians and Lutheran to swallow. Because when you think about it, it puts salt in our wounds and it shines a light on our shortcomings. You and I are kind of what we call these faith alone people. But yet Jesus is telling us this morning to plug into his power source. And so how would we do that in our lives? How can we do something that can be tasted and seen? How can we make a difference in our broken world? And I would ask you to allow me to offer a few suggestions. I would say that what we could do was look another in the eyes, speak a kind word, acknowledge them as being created in God's image, just like you and I. That sounds pretty simple. But try that with someone you would call a panhandler, someone you call a freeloader, or a welfare mother, or a bad kid. It reminded me that the time I went to Louisville shortly ago with a friend of mine, and we're walking down the street, and I see this dirty, grimy guy with a blanket over his head to keep warm, and you know me, I kind of edged over a little bit to walk around. But my friend goes over and speaks to him and puts some money in his hand, and I'm sitting there just in amazement and thinking of Jesus' words, "As you did it to the least of these." We need to be more generous with both our compassion, our time and our money and our care, and make a difference in the lives of those people who are poor and the hungry and the homeless. And I would caution you, don't try to rationalize it. That is not our job. Perhaps you can start a conversation and rebuild a relationship when what you really feel in your heart is indifference and pain or anger. How about praying that God will bless others with all of the good gifts you want for yourself and those that you love? Pray for those who are different, or who have hurt you, and those for whom you disagree. That seems almost impossible in today's world. So maybe you use your time by listening and being available and spending time with those who need you. This hit me kind of close as I struggle with this, and I've actually tried to make a resolution to become more patient and truly listen to others. How about choose a life of self-giving rather than one of taking and acquiring? Because I assure you that what you love, you are. And how about try loving God, your neighbor, and your enemy, then love yourself? Jesus is in effect telling us that it is not enough to simply show up here at River Lawn once a week, participate in the service, sing the songs, share the Eucharist and maybe learn something new, but never apply it to your life. Because to be a disciple of Christ, we must live it and we must show it to others. It's like James tells us, "You show me your faith and I'll show you my works." But I would also caution you that our good works are not ours. They don't belong to us, for they're not the source of such good works. We are simply the conduits of God's righteousness, and we need to be symbols pointing to that greater reality. You know, you've heard me say it before many times here at River Lawn, is that you and I are the only Bible that most people are ever going to see. But I would like to add something to that this morning. I would like to add that you need to preach the gospel at all times, and when necessary, use words. Let your actions show others what your Savior looks like. So where is the salt and the light in your life today? What does it look like? Where does it show up? Because in the end, they always look like Jesus. So if that's the case, then they should reflect the life that he wants us to live for him. That's why Jesus was so adamant in this lesson today that we not lose our saltiness and we not hide our light. Because when you do, you lose and you hide your life. And when we do that, we are denying Christ. And most importantly, I believe, is that he's not asking us to become something we're not. Jesus is simply asking us today to be what we are. Because the reality of it is, we are never going to get it right. We know that. We're going to fail miserably at following Jesus. We'll neglect the poor, and we're going to invariably ignore the vulnerable, and we'll fail to be the salt that we're called to be, and we'll hide our light occasionally under a bushel basket. But here is our good news today. Through the crucified Christ, we are forgiven, and we are all free to get back up and try to follow again. I read a story about a bunch of people, supposedly was true, that were all caught in an elevator years ago during a power outage. They were all strangers, and they were in this elevator shoulder to shoulder, and you can imagine, they're not talking to each other. They're scared to death, and they're panicky, and everything is dark. As they're all standing there inside, a man remembers his pen light on his keychain. And he gets the pen light out and he turns it on, and everything changed. That little bit of light totally transformed the situation that day. The fear faded. They started talking to each other. They started telling a few jokes and laughing, and they even sang some songs. And by the time they were rescued, about 45 minutes later, they had all become friends. All because of that little pin light that shone through the darkness and changed everything. I would ask as you leave this morning to remember that Jesus is saying we're here to be seasoning. We're here to be light bearers. And we know that much of the world around us is tasteless and dark. We have too many people today that are living a bland life amongst the shadows. They need flavor. They need light. They need you and me to make a difference. Because salt that is still in the shaker and light that is hidden under a basket are worthless. So go forth, flavor the life of another, carry the light of God wherever you go. Amen.
As I share with you my great prayer of thanksgiving, please pray with me. Omniscient and sovereign God, in your wisdom you created all things. With your generous grace and mercy, you sustain all. Of all creation, you created us in your image to have this special relationship with you, to love and serve, and to share the gospel with the world. Despite our failures and weaknesses throughout history, you continued to love us. With your faithfulness, you rescued us time and time again. You sent prophets, performed wonders, and in your greatest act of unconditional love, you sent your Son, Jesus, to restore us. We will forever be grateful and in awe of your majesty. Jesus, you lived among us, modeling love and grace, teaching truth, and enduring the ultimate love sacrifice to triumph over the sin of the world. Rising from the grave, you redeemed us so that we may have hope and victory over death. Holy Spirit, you have graciously come among us to comfort and guide us until Christ comes again. We hold steadfast to your promises and refresh our spirit with your word. We long for your promise of new life and the annihilation of sin. As we partake in the Lord's Supper with one another, we remember Jesus' institution of the sacrament at the Passover meal and the breaking of bread with his disciples. We remember the cross and atonement for our sin. We are brought into your holy presence, O God, united with all believers, past and present, in offering thanksgiving to you, our triune God. We look forward to one day meeting at the marriage supper of the Lamb. We gather as a family of faith to remember your covenant and our calling to feed others as we have been fed. This supper reminds us of who we are, reaffirms the promises of our baptism and our mission in the world. It is not a right bestowed upon the worthy, but a privilege given to the undeserving who come in faith, repentance, and love. We call upon you, Holy Spirit, to nourish us. In the name of our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of Christ broken for you, take and eat with thanksgiving. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant, sealed in my blood and shed for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. The blood of Christ shed for you, take and drink with thanksgiving." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes. So let us pray. O God, we thank you for this beautiful sacrament in which you have given yourself to us. Holy Spirit, continue to guide us and strengthen us as we serve faithfully until the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, as we have received your first fruits today in the Eucharist, we ask, Lord, that you will accept our gifts, the best that we have to use, to help all those others who are so less fortunate than us, who have yet to see your face as we have. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Are there any prayers that we need to remember, especially this morning? Any concerns or celebrations? Yes, Paul.
I have a celebration. I have a celebration today. My mom has stayed with us for a while, and Pam said she's an eye surgeon. I've been a little bit myself, so what better way than having your mom, when we're in the 70s, to come take care of you and not feel good.
Anyone else this morning?
This is a prayer report and a prayer request together. Our friend Brady Wolf, that we asked for prayers for, who had to have the heart valve replaced. The heart valve was perfectly fine, but the top half of her heart wasn't waking up like they wanted, so she ended up with a permanent pacemaker. But she's doing well. But just continue prayers for the healing. She keeps making comments about trying to get used to the sound of her heart because it's louder now than it was. But again, she is doing well. Continue prayers for healing and for her family.
That's for healing, correct?
Yes.
Thank you. Anything else this morning? If not, let us pray. Oh, I'm sorry.
We just have a celebration. Thank
yes. Oh, well, congratulations. Let us pray. Called together, Jesus, to follow you. We pray for this church, for the world, and all of the people around us that are in so much need. Father, we ask you to shape our congregation here at River Lawn to be salt for the earth. Give us delight in your commandments, that we are generous with those in need. Keep us steadfast, Lord, in our trust in you, and to always be ready with mercy and compassion for our neighbors. Pray, Father, that you give each of us the courage to proudly use the light you've given us to illuminate the world, especially to you. As we pray for those who have yet to meet you, use us to be your conduit, Father. We ask that you nurture all who are in need, especially people that we know in our hearts, who mourn, who suffer, who grieve, or who are infirmed. We ask that you comfort them. We pray especially this morning for Hilly. And we celebrate Paul and Pam and family in the anniversaries that we have, and pray that there'll be many more anniversaries with you. Protect those that aren't with us this morning. We ask that you look out especially for Pastor Chris. And pray that you take us all safely home and help us prepare for the coming week by turning on our lights and getting out our salt for those in need. We humbly pray all of these things in Christ's name, the one true light who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Amen.
Amen.